best and for you. Live your life with kindness and care. Remember, Allah will always be there, be there. Nikahun mubarakun, zawajun mubarakun, an-nikahu min sunnah.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. I welcome you to the special program of Better Half or Bitter Half. And in this program, you're most welcome to ask any questions related to marriage, how to conduct a nikah, regarding how married life should be led. You can ask any questions that you'd like to know before you say I do, before you say Kabul hai, before you say I accept it, or any questions related to anything that related to your life after you say I do, after you say Kabul hai, after you say I accept it. You're most welcome to ask any questions regarding marriage. In short, you're most welcome to ask any questions so that after you say I do, you should have a successful wedlock and not a padlock. So the program will start, Better Half or Bitter Half, wedlock or padlock. If any other sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Is it necessary to have the nikah in the mosque?
The sister has a question. Is it necessary to have the nikah in the mosque, or is it a sunnah to have the nikah in the mosque? There is a hadith which is mentioned in hadith of Sunnah Tirmidhi, volume number 2 in the book of nikah, hadith number 1089, which says that the Prophet said that to have nikah in the mosque, but the hadith is zaif hadith. It's a weak hadith. There is no sahih hadith that I know of in which the Prophet recommended that the nikah should take place in a mosque. But if someone wants the nikah to be conducted in a mosque, it is not haram, it's not makruh, it is mubah. If someone conducts in a mosque, it's acceptable. But it is not fard in Islam, neither it is a sunnah. But if someone wants to conduct, it is good. But the Prophet said that make nikah easy, or the best of marriage is that in which the least expenditure is made. So in this context, if someone has in the mosque, it's perfectly acceptable. It's no problem at all. But it is not fard, neither it is proven from the Quran and Hadith. But a person, if he wants, he can get married in the mosque. Hope that's the question. Any other sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Is it not injustice to give the right to divorce only to men and not to women?
So that was the question, that isn't it injustice when the right of divorce is only given to the man and not to the woman? If you realize the way Islamic marriage takes place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah says in the Quran, it's mentioned in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 40. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. And the Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 228, that the women have rights as against them, on terms equitable, but the men have a degree of advantage. So overall, the Quran says the men and women are equal, but some places they have a degree of advantage. And on the other hand, there are hadiths which the Prophet said that have respect the mother more. So there the women have a degree of advantage. But this aspect, why do the men have a degree of advantage? The reason is that when marriage takes place, one of the criteria besides the agreement of both the would-be husband and wife, there is a concept of mahr. That it's compulsory, as the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse number 4, that give to the woman a marital gift in marriage. That means mahr is compulsory for a marriage to solemnize. So when a mahr is given, the would-be wife can demand what she wants. And the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse number 20, you can even give a mountain of gold. So imagine when a marriage takes place, it is the man who is in loss economically. He gives mahr. Now once he gives the mahr, if suppose the right is given to the woman to divorce, and she divorces, who would be the loser? Would be the man. And in case if a divorce takes place, the girl can marry again. When she marries, she gets a new mare. Here, if the man marries, he has to give a new mare. So therefore, economically, the woman is secured. So based on this, generally by default, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the right to the man to divorce. And furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse number 34, Ar-rijalu qawwamuna 'ala an-nisa, that the men are the supporters of the women. For Allah has given one strength more than the other. So based on this, because man is the qawwam, he is the leader in the family, but naturally by default, the right to divorce goes to the man. Because he is the one who looks after the family, etc. But that does not mean a woman cannot demand rights. During Nikah Nama, if she wishes, she can put a condition that I too want a right to divorce. Because by default it goes to the man, but if the husband wants to give that right even to the would-be wife, he can give. So in the Nikah Nama, if the would-be wife wants to put a condition, and if the husband agrees, she can put a condition, so both will have the right. But otherwise, by default, without any rules and regulation, the right goes to the man. Otherwise, I'll have to give a talk on men's rights in Islam. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any other sister has any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Is it encouraged to marry within the same community like Cockneys marry only Cockneys?
Sister, question that, is it encouraged for a girl or a boy to marry within the same community like Cockney marrying Cockney or Meman marrying Meman? We only got stuck to Cockney because then I'm a Cockney. So it can go Sheikh marrying a Sheikh or a Sayyid marrying a Sayyid. So realize the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's preferable to marry the same type of people, same category, whether it may be in category in terms of ethnicity, whether it may be in terms of economic status, whether it be in terms of community, because the compatibility is there. Because the Kokani have a different style of living, the Meman have a different style of living, the Keralite may have a different style of living, the person, UK American person, a different style of living, the European may have. So it's easy to gel. So it is preferable, but not a fard. Similarly, imagine an African marrying a European. It can go well, not it's not possible. It's possible, but the chances of compatibility is less. Similarly, Chinese coming and marrying someone from Kerala, not that it's not possible, it's possible, but if you want to break this barrier for a cause, for example, I'm finding a more virtuous non-Kokani, then I prefer marrying a non-Kokani than marrying a Kokani. For in my case, I could not leave us at Kokani, I could not get a girl from Bombay who I wanted a virtuous, so I had to go to Pune. I had to travel 160 miles. So I not only left the community, I left the city also. So your reason to marry was virtue. So if virtue is the criteria, if you break these barriers of economic status, of nobility, of community, of ethnicity, there's no problem. Otherwise, generally, if exactly same virtues, who is from your community, not from your community, preferable, same virtues from a community. Same virtues who's rich and who's poor, and if you are rich, then same virtues who's rich is preferable. But if you find that one person more virtuous and out of the community is preferable, that one person is more important than matching your community or matching your ethnicity or matching your economic status. But if the virtue is not the criteria, otherwise marrying in the same level is preferable, so that life becomes easier. So when you have a choice to choose the easy part, it's preferable to choose the easy part than the difficult. But that does not mean, because normally in Indian culture, it's very common. Kokani should marry a Kokani, 99%. Meman should marry Meman. A Keralite Malayali should marry a Malayali. And that's the reason, you know, they look for this criteria more important than virtue. Yes, I want virtue, but should be a Kokani. I want a virtuous girl, but should be a Meman. So this is just for saying they're more looking for their community rather than virtue. So virtue should be given the most important. Hope that answers the questions. Are there any other questions?
Is it cultural or is it promoted in Islam to give preference to younger women for marriage, or to give preference to virgin over non-virgins, or to give preference over good looking to average looking women?
Sister has a question that is it cultural in Islam? Is it preferable in Islam to marry younger women as compared to elder women? To marry more beautiful women as compared to average looking women? Or more wealthier than poor? Is it preferable? It is mubah. Because if you go to the history of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the first woman that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam married, Hazrat Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her, she was 15 years elder to the Prophet. The Prophet was 25 years old, Hazrat Khadija was 40 years old. And later on, he had only one wife, till the age of 50-52, until Hazrat Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her, she expired. And only after she expired, did the Prophet marry. And after that, when he married the girls that were younger, 36 years old, 32 years old, etc. But preference over young and age, here you have an example, the first marriage is 15 years older, the next marriage is younger. You have example that the Prophet, the first wife he did, Hazrat Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her, she was a widower, so she wasn't a virgin. Amongst all the wives, only one wife was virgin. All the others, they were not virgins. They were either widowed or they were divorcees. But that does not mean it is sunnah to marry a non-virgin. Then there will be a problem. But in the life of the Prophet gave various examples. Rich, Hazrat Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her, she was very rich. The other ladies that the Prophet married, some were poor. So Prophet had an example of rich woman. He married poor woman, elderly woman, younger woman, virgin, non-virgin, more were divorcees, and they were widows. So here you find that cross-section, according to me, it's mubah. But it's a personal choice. As the Prophet said, as I mentioned earlier, according to the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, in the book of Nikah, hadith number 5090, that the beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, that when a person marries, he looks for 4 things. Beauty, wealth, nobility, and virtue. And amongst them, virtue is the best. So if someone looks for beauty, it's not haram. Someone wants a younger wife, it's not haram. Someone wants a wealthier wife, it's not haram. Someone wants a noble wife, it's not haram. But amongst them, virtue is the best. So more important is the virtue. If you find a virtuous wife and she is less beautiful, it's preferable to marry a less beautiful wife than who's less virtuous. So virtuous wife who's less beautiful is preferable than more beautiful and less virtuous. So all these things, virtue carries more weight. But Islamic, there's nothing like which is preferable in the other criteria. As far as virtues is concerned, it is preferable for sure. Hope that answers the question. Inshallah, we'll be continuing the session after a short break. Assalamu alaikum and welcome you back to the program, Better Off or Better Half. And we'll continue our question after session regarding marriage. Are there any sisters that have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
What is the duty of the daughter to her parents after marriage? Should she obey them or her husband?
This is the question that what is the duty of a daughter to her parents after she's married? Should she obey the husband or the parents? I feel she should obey both. The best is obey both. But if there is a conflict, who is more important? But naturally before marriage, obeying the parents is most important. After marriage also it's important, but once she gets married, she goes to a different family. So if there is a conflict between both, we have to see that who is more on the Quran and Sunnah. Is it the husband or is it her parents? So based on that, she makes the decision. But if both are neutral, both are not against the Quran and Sunnah, then you try and convince either of them that to change their views so that you can follow both your parents and satisfy your husband. But if there is really a conflict and both are not against Quran Sunnah and yet, so but naturally the tilt goes more towards the husband after marriage. Little bit more because you have a family to look after, but that does not mean you neglect your parents, you disobey your parents. Only if conflict is such that both are on the Quran and Sunnah and then you have to choose between one of them. So it's preferable you satisfy both. As a last resort, if you have to take a balance, but now the balance tilts more towards the husband because he becomes your immediate family, not that your parents are not. But at the same time, if you can convince your husband and yet obey your parents, that is the best. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Why is the Iddah period after the death of a husband is longer than the Iddah period after the divorce?
Sister has a question that why is the idda period after the death of a husband longer as compared to the idda period after the divorce? In both the idda, as the Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 228, that when you divorce your wife, there is an idda period of 3 menstrual cycle or 3 monthly periods. But when a person dies, the Quran says that after your husband expires, the idda period is for 4 months 10 days. So the idda period after a husband expires is 1 month 10 days longer. For divorce, it's 3 months. For after death, it's 4 months 10 days. Why? The reason the idda period is there, the various reasons, one of the major reasons after divorce that the idda period is there, to come to know whether the wife is carrying the child of the husband. So if during the idda period, there are various reasons. One reason is it's more for preliminary test, as I said, that can the husband or wife stay away from each other. So it's a temporary period. In 2 weeks you come to know, hey, I thought we got angry with my wife because she doesn't iron my clothes and I feel that let's stay away. And now I realize in 2 weeks time, I'm in a more difficult situation. Let's patch up. Let's reconciliate. Or the wife may think I'm getting angry, you know, that my husband gives me less time. He only gives me 5 hours a day. And now in 2 weeks, I realize that even if he gives me 2 hours, no problem. You know, something is better than nothing. So they can patch up. So various reasons are there. But one of the other reasons is that to come to know whether the wife is carrying the child of the husband. So if she's carrying, it extends, the idda period extends till the time of delivery. And furthermore, no one should allege that if they part and in 3 months' time, you can easily come to know without doing any medical test that is she carrying a child or not. And the olden days, there were no examination like what we have. Ultrasonography, amniocentesis, various pregnancy tests. Amniocentesis for sex determination. You don't have the pregnancy test like we have today. But pregnancy is not the only reason. But at that time, 3 months is sufficient to come to know whether the woman is carrying the child of the husband or not. Pregnancy is not the only criteria, one of the important criteria. Besides that, as I said, that can you stay away, etc., it's a preliminary period. But in case of the death of a husband, when divorce takes place, everything is planned. Planned means divorce doesn't take place suddenly. First, there's mutual consultation between husband and wife. If you go according to the correct sunnah, if you go to the wrong bidah style, talaq, 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 then it may take place in a second. You get angry and it starts, which is not Islamic at all. It's talaq bidah, as I discussed last time. If you go to the Islamic procedure of talaq, first there's mutual consultation between husband and wife. Then if that cannot be solved, then you appoint an arbiter. Then you wait. Then various, then normally divorce takes place, it takes weeks and months, sometimes even year. So it is planned and you know something is going on. And then there's the period for 3 months. Compared to in a case of husband dying, most of the time it's sudden death, maybe an accident, maybe he has a disease. Some rare cases he is terminally ill and you know he's dying slowly, but the chances are less. So most of the time in death, you don't expect your husband to die. So here the wife is in a state of mental shock. So besides coming to know whether she's carrying a child in which 3 months is sufficient, so no one lays an allegation on her that, you know, she has illicit sex, nauzubillah, with some man, and after the husband has died, she's carrying a child or someone else. So idda period is a period to know whether she's carrying the child. One of the reasons. But why is it 1 month, 10 days more? Because when the woman undergoes a sudden loss or shock that she does not have a husband, this time is given for her to settle down. That's the reason during the idda she cannot make any contract to marry someone else. And if she makes, it's not valid. After the idda is over, because, you know, maybe she's in a state of shock and someone says, I want to marry, she says, she's not secured, she's very scared, and she may agree to marry someone who's not good also. So the idda period is extended. So 4 months, 10 days is sufficient to let the mental shock come down, for the woman to come in normal state, so that she can take the decision to remarry. So it's a longer idda, longer waiting period, and she can take a much wiser decision, whether she has to marry again, who she chooses, etc. That's the reason for the idda after death of husband is longer as compared to divorce. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any other gents have any questions? Any brothers? Oh, mashallah, Arshi.
Assalamu alaikum.
So I've considered a wife. Walaikum salam.
Many young men today, they give priority to their careers as opposed to getting married soon. So they wait till they're in their mid-30s or 40s they wait too long to get married. So is there any specific thing on this that you may shed some
light? Well, that's a good question. That many a time today, the youngsters, they give more preference to the career rather than marriage. And they say, I want to make my career. Mujhe mere pair pe khada hona hai. So I said, why in the teenage also you can stand on your feet? You know, the other says, I want to stand on my own feet. That means I want to actually be financially independent. That's what they mean. They want to be a doctor or engineer or start doing a good job where they earn. So normally by the time they are settled and good job, it becomes past 30s or late 20s. That's also very early. Past 30s or mid 30s, early 30s. So how important is it to establish your career before you get married? See, marriage is part of life and career is also part of life. I feel a person should not delay the marriage just because for career or even for education. Fine. I'm not saying that he should get married in his teens. If he's mature, if he wants, he can. Islam gives permission once a person has reached puberty, he or she can. But don't delay too much. As the beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, mentioned Sahih Bukhari, one number 7, in the book of Nikah, chapter number 3, hadith number 4, that, O young people, whoever had the means to get married, they should get married. Help to lower your gaze and guard your modesty also. These people normally delay thinking, you know, what they think, that, you know, once I marry, then for me to look after my wife will be an obstruction in my studies, would be an obstruction in establishing my career. In fact, it is wrong. Imagine if a person is doing medical studies, if he's married, the wife will help him. So if you look at the positive side, if you marry and then appear for a post-graduation, it's easy, you know. She'll help you. She'll help you make notes if required. She may help you see to become it comfortable. Normally you only have your mother, now you have a mother and wife both too. So if you have a career, so what's the problem? Yes, there's a fear that if I know only when I earn myself. Therefore the Prophet said, if you have the means. So most of these people who talk, the parents are already rich. They already have a good saving. So if finance is not the problem, I feel they should get married. And in establishing the business is easier. The wife can support you. Because wife, as I mentioned, is the role of garments. So I disagree with that concept that you marry late. Because if you marry early, then you'll have your children also early. And some people say, oh, no, I want to relax. You know? Even if you have to relax, marry early. You marry in your early 20s, have children fast. By the time you're 40, your child is already 18, 19. He can sit on a business, you can retire before you reach 40. Otherwise, you wait till 60. So if you want to enjoy life also, marry early, have children, have your children take care of your business, so you can be free and you can relax earlier. So even to enjoy life, it is better you marry early. And one more thing, you don't go to the evil of society. Because when you're young, there are high chances you can be deviated. High chances that when you do your graduation and post-graduation, for you to be on the Sirat al-Mustaqim is difficult. If you have a wife, she's your Mohsen Sena, she's the fortress against the devil, and more chances that you can concentrate on your studies. When you go to school, normally in co-ed schools and colleges, they say you spend more time in trying to be a hero in front of the opposite sex than doing studies. So now you already have a heroine with you. You already have a wife with you, so you won't waste your time otherwise, and it will help you to concentrate on your studies better. So I feel even if you have to study or look after a career, it's better that you get married earlier. Hope that answers the question. And then the last question, and this is the end of the program of Better Half or Better Half. وَآخْرِ دَعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.